Hinduism, there are even rumors that he got converted to Hinduism. We know that he has dug up a lot of tanks in Tamil Nadu. And wherever he has dug up these tanks, he has done all Brahminical rites, pujas, everything. And he was condemned by this for missionaries, and so he died a mysterious death. Then came Caldwell. That's what he called him. Caldwell was a missionary. He belonged to a missionary group called Society for the Promotion of Gospel, SPG. Society for the Promotion of Gospel is a missionary group that specialized in slavery. Until emancipation, SPG was one of the missionary groups that had the largest amount of slave workers. And all the slave workers who belonged to SPG would be branded with S on their chest. And when at last emancipation came, British government compensated with almost 9,000 pounds. Sorry, 900 pounds per slave. And the 900 pounds were given not to slaves. It was given to the slave owners as a compensation for the loss of emancipating the slave. So just received a very huge amount in that. It was just after this emancipation of that, our Caldwell was coming and landing in Chennai, in Tamil Nadu, particularly in Tirunelveli area. And he got hold of this linguistic theory, and he wrote what is called the comparative grammar, which is very famous now. And he converted this linguistic theory into a racial theory, and he said that first there were these untouchables, and then came the Dravidians who were Scythians through Khyber and Pola, through the process. They came here, they conquered the untouchables, and they formed the empire here. They were living here. Then came the Aryans. The Aryans never fought with the Dravidians, but they sent their agents. Brahmins were the agents of Aryans. They were sent. These agents of Aryans, they came here and they told these kings that we are giving you the title called Sudra, which is a very honorary title. This dumb Tamil Dravidian kings accepted this title, and they got Brahminized. So he said, whatsoever there is in Tamil that does not fit into the Protestant theology of Caldwell was called Aryan interpolation. It was an Aryan cunning trick to enslave the Tamils. Pantheism, the Jati system, which was creating a real problem for Caldwell to convert. Caldwell was not worried about the egalitarianism or anything. The only thing he was worried about was this was, we are not able to convert these people until this caste system is there. So he attacked the caste system. In fact, he wrote, if we remove this Brahminical trappings that are in these brains of Dravidians, the only thing that remains between the Dravidian brain and accepting of Jesus Christ is nothing but the density of their ignorance. So he considered Dravidians to be basically ignorant people. They had this density of ignorance only, in which these Brahminical cobwebs were there. That has to be removed, and then they will easily, happily accept Jesus. That was the idea of Caldwell. Caldwell never had a high opinion of the Tamil culture or Tamil people. He considered them inferior. In fact, in his view, whoever gets enslaved by another person, the person who enslaves is culturally superior, racially superior. So, the untouchables were the worst. The Dravidians were superior. Aryans were further superior. The only problem is Aryans didn't have Christ. They had polytheism. They had pantheism. Because of that, the whole thing is sort of rigid. So we have to introduce Christ. That was the only idea that Caldwell brought. But he brought a racial theory. This racial theory was accepted. Already there were some fault lines getting created in Tamil Nadu in the Madras presidency. Already the Brahmins in Madras presidency, at least some of the Brahmins, they were accepting this Aryan race theory. They were considering themselves as Aryans and superior to the native people. We are different from you racially. They were thinking like that. In fact, if you read Swami Vivekananda's lecture in Madras, he would be warning the Brahmins in Madras, telling that you people are not keeping contact with the non-Brahmins, and it is going to create real big problems for you. In fact, the Divan of Travancore told Swami Vivekananda that we are Aryans, the others are Dravidians, we are culturally superior, and Swami Vivekananda concurred to that. Now, along with that, this man comes and he tells that no, no, these people are agents, they have brought in this kind of things, the wild things like idol worship and other aspects, then you have to revolt and things like that. Then the native Tamil scholars just grasped it. They started creating a Dravidian ideology. Once they started creating this Dravidian ideology, tears of people came. So, along with that, another one very important thing happened. Along with the college, another one man came called G.U. Po. How much time we have? So, another one important person came, G.U. Po. G.U. Po translated a lot of Tamil treatises into English. Devotional, mystical, theological, ethical treatises that were in Tamil. He translated them into English. Even today, if you ask an ordinary Tamil person, even a scholar, you ask him, what do you think of G.U. Po? He would say with emotion, he has done wonderful things for Tamil. He took the glory of Tamil culture and civilization to the entire world. So this is what he did. There are three important aspects in Tamil culture. He perceived three important aspects. One is Thirukkural. Everybody knows about Thirukkural, I suppose. Then there is Saiva Siddhanta, which is the theology of Saivism. It's a mystical theology of Saivism, which is actually a Vedantic philosophy, a branch of Vedantic philosophy. Then you have Tamil devotional literature by the devotees of Siva and Vishnu, Alvas and Ayamas. He took all this and he said that all this should have been influenced at one time or other by Christianity. He translated Thirukkural. He translated Thiruvasan. Then he said, okay, Thirukkural should have been influenced by early Christianity. How? Sir Thomas came here, Mylapore, and he was a friend of Thiruvalluvar. He should have influenced, his teachings should have influenced Thirukkural. So Thirukkural basically is a Christian text. Later, a lot of scholars, both European as well as native Tamil scholars, they have rejected this idea. But what they did not reject was, Caldwell postulated that Thirukkural is not a treatise that came from Vedic civilization, but from Jain influence. But because of the Jains that the Thirukkural came, Thirukkural is essentially a Jain work. So, once Caldwell stated that, and he stated that it was Christian, both of them agreed on one thing, that Thirukkural does not have Vedic roots. Even now, most of the Tamil rhetoric, political rhetoric, the Dravidian political rhetoric, it assumes that Thirukkural is a secular or Jain text. But it is only a preparation, as we will see later, that it is only a preparatory state for telling that this text was actually a Christian text. Now, so, this is what G.U. Po did. Now came the Theosophy. Theosophy brought with it the idea of Lemuria. Sunken continent, a mystical continent that was there, where there were the original inhabitants and things like that. Particularly in Tamil native scholars, they were very much attracted by this idea. So they said, okay, we had a big continent that connected Tamil Nadu with the Africa. This was called Kumarikandam, which was also called Lemuria, and the Tamils were natives of this Kumarikandam. So once they have created this idea, they have internalized this idea, they have created big narratives. Meanwhile, Theosophy, what it did was, it brought together the idea of Aryan race, Sinhalese language, and Buddhism, and it created a construct. The idea that Sinhalese language is Aryan and Tamil language is Dravidian was a very arbitrary debate that was created by Max Muller and Caldwell. So Max Muller said that there are certain cognate words in Sinhalese language that is similar to words in a language in Finland or Iceland. So, Sinhalese language should be Aryan language, and those who speak the Sinhalese language are Aryan race people. So, the Tamils are already being established as the Dravidian people, So this single is an Aryan people, and here is Buddhism, which is an Aryan Dharma, Aryan path. You combine all these together, you have a master Singhalese race. So to counter it, you have Sivism, Tamil and Dravidian identity. So you have created two different identities. And the mischief was played by the colonial administrator. They made that it made it compulsory that you should get a whether you are a Singhalese Aryan or Tamil Dravidian in the census. Before that, the identity was somewhat nebulous. You may be a Tamil, your daughter or your son may marry a Singhalese, then their daughter or son may marry a Tamil. It is sort of, the identity was not fixed, it was not rigid. It was moving here and there. You have a parallel, very clear parallel in African history. When the European explorers went to Africa, they had the idea of Hamitic concept. The blacks belong to the Hamitic race. However, during the Napoleonic exploration, Napoleonic wars, they encountered the pyramids, the great Egyptian civilization, and they found that most of the creators of the pyramids were black pharaohs, black people. How to reconcile this? So they said, these people were Hamitic people, but they were sort of impregnated with the white blood from invaders from settlement who were coming on farms with the iron technology. As you go progressively into Africa, you will find the grades of white blood impregnating the black native Africans. So you will have civilization going down, down, down. They created a system like this. So when Rwanda came under the Belgian rule, the Belgian fathers, the Belgian white missionaries, as well as the colonial administrators, they came there, they found there were two societies, two social groups, Tutsis and Hutus. One of these groups were cattle owners and another one was land owners. And if you are having a land, and if I fall into some bad times and I sell the land, I get the cattle, I become a Hutu. Or I become a Tutsi. It was a flexible identity. These people came and they told that the Tutsis were white, they have white blood. They were a shade whiter than the Hutus. So these Hutus were being civilized by the Tutsis. They belong to, they somehow they are related to us racially. So what they did, almost all government jobs, everything they went, they gave to the Tutsis. And they made the Tutsi Hutu difference into a racial difference. Either you are a Tutsi or you are a Hutu, that's all. And it is fixed and it goes in a hereditary way. Once they created this, what happened? The Tutsis started becoming, occupying the important colonial administrative places and in education and everything. The national liberation movement in Rwanda had mostly the Tutsis. Now the colonial administrators and the missionaries saw this, then they said to the Hutus, see, you are the sons of the soil. These Tutsis were alien invaders. They have come from outside, just like us. They have come from outside. If they give you independence, tomorrow the Tutsis will be overruling you, they will be subjugating you, so you need reservations, you need all sorts of affirmative action, you need a political will and a political movement to curb the Tutsi supremacy. So this created a divide. The Hutus created a movement, the Hutus Liberation Movement. Its charter was penned down by the Belgian missionaries. And they said, exactly, if you compare what the missionaries told the Hutus and what Paul told the so-called Dravidians, you will find them to be almost reflections of each other. You can just change the words, names of the different social groups and you will find them fitting each other perfectly. And he told these people, these Tutsis, they never won you. They, through cunning agents, they simply manipulated and they have made you slaves. All this happened. It created a lot of rivalry between the two groups. Ultimately, in 1998, it created one of the worst genocides in the history of modern world. After the Holocaust, this